Hello, I'm Cheng, a second-year PhD student at Columbia University. Today, I'll present Iterative Residual Policy, a joint work with Toyota Research Institute. We consider the task of goal-conditioned dynamic manipulation of deformable objects, such as accurately hitting a target with an unknown rope, or swinging a tablecloth to a precise location. To the best of our knowledge, no existing robotic systems can solve this task. Why is it so hard? First, with dynamic actions, we can no longer ignore the object's physics during planning. Yet the physics of deformable objects are notoriously difficult to model. And even with a perfect model, we all know how hard it is to tune the simulation parameters for even just one object. And to make things worse, our tasks require high precision to achieve the goal with a tolerance of a few centimeters. And to be honest, the whipping task in particular is quite hard even for me. If I have never tried a particular rope, it's close to impossible for me to hit the target in my first try. However, I can get closer and closer after each attempt and eventually hit the goal. So what did I learn during this process? Did I learn the mapping from action to full trajectory? I don't think I can. Did I decode key rope parameters, such as its length or density? I don't think I can either. Did I bump into the goal via random acceleration? Unlikely, given the size of action space and the tight tolerance required. However, these are the popular methods we use today to solve similar problems. If that's not what we learned, then what is it? I think I have this intuition about how adjusting my action will affect the trajectory. For example, swinging harder will make the rope reach higher, and extending my arm will make the tip go further. It's hard to say how the trajectory will change, but my guess for which direction to change my action is almost always correct. And our hypothesis is the knowledge about this change, or at least its general direction, is much easier to learn and transferable to different objects. In this paper, we formalize this intuition into an algorithm called Iterative Residual Policy. And here's how it works. At its core, the algorithm learns a delta dynamics model that takes in the observed trajectory and a delta action, and it predicts the updated trajectory after applying the delta action. Here, the robot action is parameterized with two target joint angles and the maximum joint speed, and the delta action is the change between the previous action parameters and the next one. The trajectories are represented as occupancy maps. By sampling different delta actions and predict their corresponding trajectory, the algorithm could iteratively select a better action and get closer and closer to the goal. Note, this delta dynamics model is trained entirely in simulation. And here is the rope trajectory in sim with measured parameters and the corresponding trajectory in real. And as you can see, this task has a huge sim to real gap. But we hope that the learned delta dynamics can lead us toward a general correct direction, and a simulation don't have to be very accurate. And here is a system in action. We track the tip of the rope with a camera and use its trajectory as input. The error is measured by the shortest distance to the goal along the trajectory. And then the algorithm will sample a set of delta actions from a Gaussian distribution, which is scaled proportionally with the error. The delta dynamics model predicts the resulting trajectory for each, and the delta action associated with the smallest error is selected. This process will repeat until convergence, and in our experience, the system generally converges within 10 steps. Okay, that's for one rope. In our experiments, we want to systematically test our system's generalization capability to ropes with significantly different physical parameters. In all following experiments, we use exactly the same model trained in simulation. Here, I want to highlight how big is the difference between different rope dynamics. What you see here are several rope trajectories under the same robot action. The second one is not really a rope. It's a long piece of cloth and has much higher air resistance. The third one is a bullwhip, which is quite stiff and has non-uniform linear density. The effect of these properties are not captured at all in our training data collected in simulator. Therefore, it really requires the robot to adapt its action based on visual feedback in order to generalize to these novel ropes. And here is the resulting trajectory after the policy converges on each goal. We can see the algorithm will choose different actions to achieve the same goal in order to accommodate different rope dynamics. The precision here is very close to the limit of trajectory image resolution. We also want to highlight our sample efficiency here, since all of these results converge in less than 10 steps. We then test a less common form of generalization capability against different robot hardware embodiments. Here, we change the length of the robot's last link, which changes the mapping between action space and its effect. Again, the same model trained in simulation is used. As expected, the robot with a different link comparing to the training setup started out with a higher initial error, but regardless, it's able to adjust quickly according to visual feedback. And here is numbers in real-world experiments. The left column stands for optimal action in simulation, which is a really strong baseline. We basically manually measured the rope parameters for each rope, modeled them in simulator, and optimized the action for each rope individually. This represents an upper bound of analytical model-based control using our simulator. Still, it results in more than 10 cm error, highlighting the big sim-to-real gap. In comparison, our method achieves an error that's an order of magnitude lower. Here, we want to stress test our method's robustness against unexpected changes. We first let the system converge on a given rope and goal. We then tie several knots on the rope in the middle of an experiment. This makes it shorter and increases the linear density. We can immediately observe a much higher error, but the policy can quickly adapt to the new system dynamics and regain good performance. This actually happens to us several times organically. We only saw a spike in loss, but the system still works. Finally, to demonstrate the generality of IRP framework, we apply the same method to the clause placement task with some minimum modifications. The goal of the task is to place clause on a table given a target pose, where the pose is defined by 9 key point locations on the cloth. Dynamic action is required here, since some target poses are outside of robot's reach range. Here are two typical strategies learned by the algorithm. To start, the same initial action is used regardless of the goal. In the left example, the cloth landed a bit too close compared to the goal, while in the other example, the cloth folded up by itself due to high density. With that observation, the policy will increase the stroke in the first case to swing further, and decrease speed to prevent folding in the second case. Then the algorithm will continue to adjust its action until it reaches a goal, which typically takes 3 steps for this task. And here's our takeaway. While we only tested on 2 tasks, the formulation of iterative residual policy itself is pretty general, and is applicable to many tasks with complex dynamics. As long as we can reset the system to the same initial state after failed attempts, executing the same action twice will produce the same result, and the key state and goals can be tracked as key points. What we learned from this project is that instead of modeling the full forward dynamics model, which maps from action to their effect, modeling the changes of action to changes in trajectory is much easier to learn and generalizable, since the general direction of this change is invariant against many physical parameters we have tested. From another perspective, we can also see IRP as a new way to distill relevant knowledge from existing simulators. We also hope that IRP can serve as a message to our community to further investigate smarter ways of using inaccurate simulators. Please check out our website for code and data.